Our lesson tonight will be presented by our pastor, Pastor Brown. Hear ye him.
We reverence God and thank him for our being here this evening. And we thank you, Brother Superintendent, Brother William Collins, for leading us and opening us up. And thank each one for their participation thus far in the devotion and the opening of our study of the lesson, the marriage of the Lamb. And a lot of people don't know or didn't know that this is the ultimate goal of what God has been doing and what God has been planning and what God has been executing. That there is going to be a marriage, and it is going to be a marriage between Christ and the bride. And the bride, which is one of the lesser names, is the church. The church makes up the bride. And of course, hallelujah, from the root word hallelujah, meaning praises to Jehovah, Jah. The Jah on the end of it. It praises to Jehovah. And just hallelujah is just praises to God. And so, and then the suggestion of one way to help his or her church overcome one unbride-like tendency. Well, all you got to do is think about what a bride should be like and just think about some of the things that brides have done that are unbride-like. Amen. Let me just give you one. Y'all can think of the rest. Amen. Cheating on the groom.
Not being true.
That's unbride-like. Amen. Knowing that the wedding day is coming. Amen. Well, the lesson tonight is going to be divided into three different portions. Heaven's people will be our initial start, verses 1-3, praises to the great God, honor to the great judge, justice to all eternity. For all eternity. And part two is going to be the throne, Revelation 19:4-5. We talk about worship and we talk about the command. And then thirdly, unified multitude, Revelation 19:6-8. The triple voice, the triple command, and the reason. And conclusion is say yes to the dress. Amen. Say yes to the dress. I really want to, and I know I normally don't go to it early and sometimes I don't go to it at all, but I want to start with say yes to the dress. Got your clothing ready. Weddings are designed to create memories and ingrain those memories in the mind of those who attend. Therefore, the wedding party's clothes are normally chosen with great care, coordinated for maximum effect. The wedding party may take hours to get ready for the ceremony because the wedding ceremony will be remembered for years for its beauty as well as its glitches. Everyone goes to great lengths to ensure everything is perfect for the wedding. The wedding ceremony between the Lamb and his bride culminates in the rescue of the bride from the power of sin and evil. When Jesus, the Lamb, receives his bride, the church, it will be the wedding for all time, and let me throw in an eternity. The groom has done his part by paying the price for sin on the cross. But the bride, according to scripture, has also done her part. And she has a part to do considering John's statement that she has made herself ready. Revelation 19:7. Jesus has provided us with garments of salvation and a robe of his righteousness. Isaiah 61:10, but we must put them on. So I'm telling you to get ready because the bridegroom is coming and the bride needs to be ready. And you only get one chance at this. You only get one chance. The lesson background deals with Babylon. Some say that Babylon, or the reference to Babylon, is a code word for Rome. Because at this time, at the time of the New Testament in the AD, Anno Domini, the year of our Lord, Babylon does not exist. In fact, Babylon, the memory of Babylon, has really been wiped out. But Babylon carries with it a figurative expression. Babylon really is the picture of forces that opposes the will of God and opposes his people. I'm gonna throw this out, then I'm gonna duck. America is becoming the new Babylon. Opposes the will of God and opposes his people. It is, of course, a figurative language. It doesn't mean that it's not real, doesn't mean that it's just fictional. But the language has reference that is understood by the recipients of the letter of that day to indicate the systems that man allows to rule them are becoming corrupt. And in the corruption of the systems, amen. The opposition to God, the opposition to God's will, and the opposition to God's people, that's what Rome did. And if we're not careful, and so it is with the word Babylon, the actual city, as I said, didn't even exist back then. In apocalyptic literature, frequently use vivid images to make a point. And the image of Babylon does just that. Babylon symbolizes worldly powers. Worldly powers that oppose God and his people. And so the question now is, are there worldly powers that oppose God and his people? Are they?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Does communist China oppose God and his people? Do the Arab nations oppose God and his people? They are symbols. Some scholars propose that for John's audience, Babylon was a code name, as I said again, for the city of Rome. Again, Rome opposed God and ultimately opposed his people. Prior to today's message, Revelation 18 sketches a lengthy celebration of the downfall of Babylon, rehearsing charges against it. The prophet text guarantees by extension the ultimate downfall of all kingdoms and entities that oppose God. Yes, all kingdoms, all entities that oppose God are headed for a fall. Today's passage takes us to what happens after the collapse of those foolish opponents. First thing is heaven's people praise to the great God. Verse 1 says, and after these things, I heard a great voice and much people in heaven saying, and again, after these things, the announcement of judgment and the destruction of Babylon, the great voice of much people speaking in unison reminds us of the great crowds of the redeemed in previous visions of the throne room in heaven. And what are they saying? Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Praise
salvation God. And glory.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. Mm-hmm. This is, of course, this is a familiar litany of divine action. Salvation is divine action. And then divine attributes, glory and honor and power.
Okay.
This is a litany of celebration of who God is. Honor to the great judge, for true and righteous are his judgments. And he hath judged, amen. I heard Brother Malcolm say the great harlot. My Bible says the great whore.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Which did corrupt the earth with her fornication. It focuses on God. It focuses of God's victory over the great harlot, the great whore, Babylon. As stated in Revelation 18, his judgment on her has been true and righteous, as all have ever been and ever will be. One of Babylon's two great sins is that she corrupt the earth with her fornication.
Call me, what do you want?
This is the vivid figure of speech as used in the prophets describes idolatry. Anything you put before God, anything that you esteem more important than God, can become idolatry. This corrosive influence had affected all nations. He called it fornication, sexual sin. Fulfillment of sexual desire outside of God's realm of marriage. John's original audience would have been clear on the understanding of this referring to Rome. Verse 2b, and have avenged the blood of his servants as at her hand. The corrupt systems of this world has called great pain and suffering in the lives of many believers. And a lot of people doing things that are not right. And we think they're getting away with it. And they think they're getting away with it. But God is going to avenge. God's going to avenge blood of his servants. God's going to avenge the corruption and how these nations have spread it ungodliness. The great sins of Babylon, two great sins, persecuting God's servants to the point of death, and to the point where the cry came out, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood? Psalms 13 and 1, if we remain faithful to God, then he will save us for all eternity. The multitude of heaven see the destruction of the great whore for what is really, for it really is, a magnification of the power of God, who is faithful to keep his promises to those who are faithful to him. I told you all, I don't believe personally we've seen the full demonstration of God's power. Now, we already know ain't nothing he can't handle. We already know ain't nobody he can't handle. But there appear to be some people in our nation and in our world who are above and beyond the law of man and the rule of God. But can I tell you, I'm let you in on a secret. They will be dealt with. And they'll be dealt with by somebody who they won't be able to oppose, won't be able to conjure up support from political figures. Because God, when God comes after a person to deal with them, can't nobody give you no help. Somebody ought to help me. When God is against you, ain't nobody can help you.
Amen.
He said to Israel, don't go to Egypt for help. Egypt gonna need help themselves. Don't turn to others when you can turn to God. And a lot of us are looking and seeking help and seeking our deliverance by other means and through other sources, when our first seeking ought to be to God, and then let God direct our path. Justice for all eternity. And again, verse 3 says, they said, hallelujah. This is the second one. And her smoke rose up forever and ever. What does it mean, her smoke rose up? Anybody got an idea? I know the writer gives you an implication, but anybody got an idea of what her smoke rose up means? All right. What was the sign of a city being overthrown?
They burned it down.
It's on fire.
Smoke is going up in the air where they burnt it.
It's on fire. The Lord said, I'm gonna cook up for them. Her smoke is gonna rise up forever. The great crowd of heavenly voices cries out with a second of four occurrences. Hallelujah. John uses the repetition to bring home the point. God is truly victorious and thus truly worthy of our praise. The crowd's desire for her smoke to continue rising up forever and ever, which means that she's not just conquered for a season, but she's conquered forever. Acknowledge that the destruction of the wicked city is not temporary, but it's permanent and final. I don't know about you, but I'm glad that what God lets happen to me now is just temporary. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days. I've had some sleepless nights. But I look around, I think things over. My good days outweigh my bad days. And it's not going to be for eternity. So I'm going to go through now. But it's not going to last always. Although the words forever are enough to assure that this punishment is everlasting, the extra and ever cements the certainty. The permanence of this judgment is ironclad. This judgment parallels the eternal reign of God and the eternal nature of his kingdom. When God comes against a people, a nation, a culture, an ideology, he can destroy it forever. John Visions echoes similar language from the prophet Isaiah, where God's judgment on the land is described as burning, and where the smoke thereof shall go up forever. And that's Isaiah 34, verses 9 and 10. The second thing we see in this is the throne. That's verses 4 through 5. And at the throne, we see worship. What verse 4 said, and the 4 and 20 elders of the 4 and the 4 beasts fell down and worshiped God that sat on the throne, saying, amen, hallelujah. The second declaration of worship comes this time from the 4 and 20 elders, together with the 4 beasts living creatures. They surrounded God's throne at the inner circle of those in the presence of God Almighty. We heard what the crowd is doing. The crowd is celebrating the fall of Babylon. The crowd is crying out, hallelujah. And then when you get to the throne room, the 24 elders and the four beasts are crying out, hallelujah. While the number 24, we can deal with it, but some say it's 12 from the tribe of Israel and 12 from the apostle. We really don't know what it is fully, but we know this. They are people of position and authority. Some of them even have crowns, but they so enamored by God and what he's done, they are falling down before him and crying hallelujah. Their united acclamation of worship consists of just two words. Amen. It's true. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's true. Praise God. It's true. Praise God. It's true. Praise. Regarding the former, we look at Revelation 7 and 12 in lesson 10. Regarding the latter, 19:1b, the combined effect is to affirm the praise of the great crowd in 19:3 and repeat its central component, which is praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. There's a celebration coming. Praise the Lord. The enemy is going to be overthrown. It's true. Praise the Lord. And a voice came from out of the throne saying, praise. Now, hallelujah has been praised the Lord. Here's one says, praise our God. Another voice. We don't know who this voice is. There's speculation. But we don't know who this voice is. But we know this voice joined the 24 elders and the four beast in saying, praise our God. The throne itself always refers to the presence and the authority of God. Even so, the voice is like not from God or from the Lamb. It's uncertain whether it is from an angel, herald, or another entity. What is important is that the voice has divine authorization to call for worship. When we understand the true nature of God, then we can praise him even in the midst of our deepest sorrow. In the midst of our toughest trials, we can do this because we understand that he's worthy. We also offer praise because we know that God's purposes are eternal. His salvation is sure. That his victory is guaranteed. And the victory of God is not only guaranteed, but is always complete. What Jesus did on Calvary, don't need us to add nothing to it. Jesus completed his work. The form of worship demonstrated here differs slightly from the previous exclamations. Rather than the word praise the Lord, they call it praise our God. This echoes the commands of Psalm 66 and 8. Find me all ye his servants and ye that fear him, both small and great, ought to praise him. Type of fear in view of not. A view is not that of terror of those in Revelation 6, 15 through 17. Revelation refers to those who revere God. If we revere God, if we are his servants, we are to praise him. The phrase small and great indicates the inclusive nature of this imperative. Don't matter what your status, don't matter what your position, don't matter who you think you are, everybody. The psalmist closed out his the whole psalm, five books, by saying, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. praise ye the Lord. And whatever status symbol you have here won't mean nothing in heaven. Ain't gonna be no Reverend Doctor. Ain't gonna be no Bishop. Ain't gonna be no Mother Superior. We're all gonna be servants of the Most High God. Everybody is called.
I'm glad to be there.
Praise God. Everybody is called to exalt his holy name. And look at the unified multitude. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude. And as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering. Look at what John hears here. Let me note, you can note that throughout this whole scene in chapter 19, John doesn't tell you he saw anything. He heard it. All right. Y'all think about it. John said, I heard. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We walk by faith and not by sight. John heard these things and how great they were. John hears yet another voice, this time only described as similar to a great multitude. This seems to be a different group. However, then the group mentioned in Revelation 19:1, the sound likened to many waters is not that of a soothing, bubbling brook. Rather, the sound is more like that of a thunderous waterfall or the crashing of a stormy wave upon the seashore. The word translated mighty thundering occurs 10 times in this book of Revelation. The word is always associated with divine power, divine authority, and or initiative. It's used in the verse at hand alongside the sound of water bears strong similarity to the prophet's vision in Ezekiel 1:24. Description of this stupendous chorus of voices emphasizes the size of this crowd. And I was looking at a football game the other day, and it was over 100,000 people in the stand. And when that 100,000 people all began to chant the same thing, it sounded like thunder. They were so loud. And they were doing this at a football game. Can you imagine what John said he saw earlier? 10,000 times 10,000, all crying out at the same time, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ooh. Praise God. And to him be glory. Thousands of voices giving him praise. Hallelujah. Verse 6b. We come now to the fourth and final hallelujah in the book of Revelation. Again, see insight on the term. The imperative is to praise God. Is accompanied by a reason to do so. Why should we praise God? Woo! The writer said, for the Lord God is omnipotent, reigneth. Mm. Omnipotent, all power. God's action are often grouped under three headings. He creates, he rules, and he redeems. The text before us speaks to the second of those. He rules. In that light, the praise is for the universal kingship of the Lord God. There can be no rival to God, either in his rule or in our praise of him. God ought to get a praise from us that nobody else can get, because ain't nobody like him. In describing the nature of God's power to reign, the verse introduced us to one of the mighty, or what might be called the three omnis. The word omnipotent means all powerful. The word omnipresent means everywhere at the same time. The word omniscient means he is all knowing. God's power to reign is demonstrated by his overwhelming and permanent victory over enemies. Now his all-powerful nature brings his promises to their completion. What's the completion? He says in verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. Three more imperatives. Now added to the one hallelujah above. What are these imperatives? Be glad, rejoice, and give honor to him. We gonna be glad. Those that make it in gonna be glad. I'm gonna say it again. Those that make it in gonna be glad. They gonna rejoice and they gonna give honor to him. Verse 7, here is the conclusion. For the marriage of the Lamb is come. This is the reason for the unique triple command of the half verse just considered. It is the moment of faithful and been waiting for. The faithful have been waiting for this moment. The time and the occasion when the faithful servants of God see their eternal heavenly fellowship with their Savior, Jesus Christ. It's going to be finalized. And whoa, what joy. This is the moment when all God's work throughout history moves toward its magnificent conclusion. Or in music, it is called the crescendo, the ultimate part of it. The wedding language we see here was not unfamiliar to John's original audience. Old Testament prophets often use marriage as a figurative reference to describe the relationship between God and his people. I heard Hosea said, God said, I'm married to the backslider. That's why I love him so. Jesus too described the kingdom of heaven in terms of a marriage. A marriage requires two parties, a bride and a groom. The groom in view here is the Lamb. Various forms of the word Lamb, but the groom is the Lamb. Outside of the book of Revelation, John the Baptist referred to Jesus as the Lamb of God and said he takes away the sins of the world. People said that Jesus was a lamb without blemish and without spot. The idea of Christ as the sacrificial lamb lies at the very heart of our redemption and salvation. Verse 7c and verse 8 says, and his wife had made herself ready. Has the church made herself ready? Have we got ready for the bride, for the groom? The story of the virgins tells that we got to stay ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen. It was granted. It was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. How we get to wear fine linen, clean and white? Because of Jesus. Amen. Because of Jesus. The book of Revelation is loaded with figurative language. And the image of one thing is used to express another. This is the great challenge of interpreting sometimes. But he's saying that when the Lord gets through, listen, doesn't he say that he shall present the church before him without spot or blemish? Righteousness of the saint is reflected in the garment of the bride. This imagery reflects the holiness of the bride, having been redeemed by the Lamb. clothing imagery serves important figurative purposes in the Bible. John uses the use of wedding imagery speaks to the relationship between God and his people. The bride of Christ is the church. Holy one, sanctified by the work of the Holy Spirit. The bride has been redeemed because of the blood of the Lamb. The very same blood applied to those who washed their robes and made them white. And that's Revelation 7:14. The time for rejoicing is coming. Like a bride engaged to be married, the church awaits the return of Christ and the eternal marriage feast between the bride and the groom. And I don't know about you, but I want to be ready when Jesus comes. I want to rejoice. I want to be glad. I may not be as clean as I need to be then, but oh, when he comes, he's going to present us without spot or wrinkle. Somebody said we need some more cleaning and we need some more ironing. That's all right. Grace can do it. Grace can clean us up. And the power of his spirit can iron out some of them wrinkles in our lives. I want to be at the wedding. In fact, I want to be in the wedding. I want to be a part of a bridal party. Amen. I want to be a part of the bridal party. And I want to cry out, hallelujah. Praises to God. Hallelujah. Praises to Jehovah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
They did it four times. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God.
Hallelujah. He's worthy.
Yes, sir.
To be praised. He's worthy to be praised. There's something coming. And oh, when all of us get together and we all on one accord and we've all been cleansed by the power of the Lamb, we're going to have a time. What a time. What a time. What a time. I'm going to sit down by the banks of the river. What a time. What a time. What a time. Well, Brother Superintendent, that's all I have. If there are no questions on this lesson tonight, that's it.
Never know.
For loving me so.
Yeah. Thank you for your.